Hello. I have to thank you, the organization of the CUBE Aspire 2021 meeting, to invite me again, because it's always my pleasure to be with you all. Today, I have to talk about platelets and platelet accuracy and pseudothrombopenia. And for that, I have prepared a presentation for all of you. Let me share my screen. Okay. Platelet accuracy and causes of platelet inaccuracy. As we know, one of the more common causes for platelet inaccuracy is fragmented red blood cells that can interfere in the platelet counting. As you can see here in the center, there is an histogram of a case with fragments in that the red cells enters in the area of platelets, but we don't know if these are really red cells or platelets, and we don't know if this histogram falls here or falls here. The same for the platelets. We don't know if the platelets are here or these are also platelets. It's difficult. And to put a moving threshold or another systems that cut the edges will not be effective here. But as you can see here in the top, using optical platelets and the fluorescence channel also used for reticulocytes, you can see that the platelets are here in this area, here the fragments, here the red cells, and here the reticulocytes, and that really permits to count a very good count of platelets in presence of fragments. Also schizocytes, also presence of sickle cells, any red cell abnormality can be differentiated very well now with the actual technologies. Another possible reason for platelet inaccuracy are the cytoplasmic fragments of nucleated cells. We can see here a case of a blast with a fragment that is increased when you are giving chemotherapy, because the chemotherapy provoke apoptosis, and the apoptosis provoke that fragments of the cells appears as platelets, and many counters are counting these as platelets, but using fluorescence and optical platelets, these particles don't have nucleic acids and the fluorescence is negative. And you can differentiate again these particles from platelets using optical platelets. Cryoglobulins, we have here in the right, center in the right, a case with cryoglobulins, and that can also interfere in the impedance count, but not using optical platelets. Bacteria or fungi, you can see here diplococcus that can be counted as platelets, or fungi, and the spores of the fungi can be appearing as platelets. Another possible interference are lipids. Here we can see the blood smear of a case with lipids, in that you can see that these particles that can be different sizes can be confused with platelets. And that happens in patients in intensive care or with parenteral nutrition, that in that we can see that appears these lipids in the blood. Last but not least, severe thrombocytosis is a cause of the opposite, not thrombopenia, but thrombocytosis, in that some instruments don't count very well the platelets in the high value. Even if the operations manual say up to linear, up to 1 million or up to 2 million, if we dilute the samples 1.3 or even 1.5 in counting of 1 million or 1,500,000, we will see that not many times when you dilute 1.3 or 1.5 and you multiply times 3 or times 5, you will not reproduce the first count. And that represents that there is a coincidence phenomenon that some two or three platelets appear as one because there are too much. And even if you use laminar flow, the platelets appear wrong, and this is a known phenomenon from the time of Wallace Coulter and the first automated hematology instruments. At the end, but also the more important and the more important or the more frequent causes of platelet inaccuracy are EDTA dependent agglutination and platelet satellites. Here we can see the histograms of optical platelets, in that we can see the fragments, the lipids, how using the CUBE, we can differentiate it very well from other possible interference. the presence of candida that also, again, using the cube, can appears as an abnormal pattern of erythroblast that we can see that it is not the typical pattern of erythroblast. Also, you have a flag for the erythroblast counting, and you can see also in the diff channel, candidas, lipids. If you train your users, your lab technicians, if you have a poster nearby the instrument with examples of cases, that will help to detect this interference in your lab. But the important is when you use optical platelets, this interference, because these particles don't have nucleic acids, they are not counted as platelets. Now we are going to see the EDTA-dependent. EDTA-dependent pseudothrombocytopenia. Here we can see a typical histogram of, with platelet clumps, big platelet clumps, that really it's difficult to count very well the platelets because they are aggregated and they are not, you know, that you know when you see this histogram, these platelets are going to be wrong. First definition, EDTA-dependent pseudothrombocytopenia was described the first in 1973 by Schreiner. Some other authors talk about that, but officially, because this was a scientific article, that you have a, you define that when it's a false low platelet count. Pay attention to that. False low, lower than the good one. Not always thrombopenia, in the presence of ADTA, but also in presence of other anticoagulants. And the evidence of that is when you change the method, you use another anticoagulant, or you use another method, warming, or you mixing or adding substances, the platelet increase. That will never happen with a real thrombopenia, that the platelets increase after warming or after mixing of after adding any substance. For this reason, that is one of the confirmations, because you can find platelet clumps in case of a bad blood draw, in that there is really the initiated the cascade of the coagulation and really are normal coagulation phenomenon that will not be recovered after mixing, warming, and so on. And also you can see platelet satellites that we need to investigate in every case of thrombopenia, because platelets can be also around the neutrophils and is caused by the same phenomenon. Here we have a typical example of platelet pseudothrombopenia, in that the instrument first was running platelets by impedance, because the count in this lab have a rule that indicates optical method when the platelets are low, that it was activated, the channel, the sample was rerun, and was incorporated an optical platelet counting. And this optical platelet counting gave 198, corrected absolutely using EDTA, but using a Mindray instrument with all these technologies that we are going to see afterwards. The same sample with citrate, you see that the count with optical platelets was 253, but pay attention, impedance show a count of 217. Even with citrate, the platelets are lower than using optical. That represents that citrate prevents somehow the problem, are not 20,000, are 217, but it's not enough. Impedance with citrate is not enough. I think you need to use a special channel like that to avoid a thrombopenia, because if not, you are going to provide a not accurate result. And you can see the films of these two examples, the tube, ADTA tube, doing a blood smear from this tube, you can see the aggregates, and doing a blood smear from the citrate tube, you can see less aggregates, but pay attention, you can see a small aggregates of few platelets are not really nicely separated. That represents that citrate improves, but not always solves the problem. Now let me explain you about facts about platelet pseudothrombopenia. This is a topic that has been investigated for many, many years in my life. The first fact, it's an in vitro thrombopenia mainly, not always, but mainly, and not in vivo. That represents that the patients that have pseudothrombopenia don't have clinical features of thrombopenia, don't have hematomas, don't have, bleeding, epistaxis, hypermenorrhea, etc. It's only a lab issue. Second, how to detect it? You can review all the platelets that are less than 150, for sure, that will be better, but sometimes will require a lot of efforts in the lab. The consensus that I participated, gratefully, in was published in Lab Hematology, that we create a set of rules that says that when the platelets are less than 100, you need to review always in the microscope, even if you trust your instrument, even whatever. Is mandatory, and if you don't do it, you can be blamed, because these rules are published and are respected by many users in the world. That represents that every count less than 100 first time, if it's a known patient, you know that it's a pseudothrombopenia or chemotherapy or whatever reason, but first time you need to review the microscope and to see what? To see if there are big platelets, if there are platelet clumps, if there is platelet satellites, etc., etc. This is the rule. Okay, another fact. There are real autoantibodies. There is no an artifact that the anticoagulant makes the platelet aggregate only. No, it is really, there are really autoantibodies against cryptoantigens. Cryptoantigens represents that are antigens that in the peripheral blood, the platelets don't show, but these cryptoantigens appears in presence of EDTA. EDTA modify the membrane shape and shows glycoproteins that were not shown before or were not shown in the same way. And that provokes that, because there are antibodies against these cryptoantigens, you see the thrombopenia. But not only with, as we have explained, not only by EDTA, you can see that also using sodium citrate, and rarely by heparin, but also with heparin. We have seen cases that you have a thrombopenia due to heparin. But also recently, in 2015, there are cases in that is published platelet pseudothrombopenia by EDTA, but also immune thrombopenia. That represents that the patient have both, and that is an explanation that this is not just an artifact, because some patients have both. That represents that maybe it's like a previous step to have an ITP. Another important fact that you can see published in 2018 by Zhang, that in cases that all the anticoagulants provoke platelet aggregation, but when you collect the sample from the patient and immediately run in the instrument, there is no thrombopenia, you have to investigate the presence of von Willebrand disease type 2B, because it looks like this hereditary disorder makes a special platelet behavior that provokes this phenomenon. Another fact is the antibodies that produce PCTP are better at cold temperature. It's a cryoagglutination, and warming the sample is, you always improve or avoid a little this problem. And as well as in platelet satellites or leukoagglutination, that is another phenomenon similar to pseudothrombopenia, that putting the sample, warming the sample, you reduce the phenomenon. Another fact is this pseudothrombopenia is time dependent. The kinetics of this aggregation, it's very interesting. You can see this article from Lin et al. In 2015, that the manual platelet counting was 146. But if you see the counting by impedance in EDTA, after 10 minutes of the blood draw, the platelets were 109, lower platelets than the manual, but in 1 hour, they fell to 63,000, in 2 hours, 54,000, and in 4 hours, 50,000. That represents that during the time, the aggregation increases and the platelets goes down. But also with citrate is higher, not as high as the good value, that is 146, 139, but it's not perfect, better. And you can see that after the time, also they decrease with citrate, 139, 102, 98, and 91. And that is an interesting feature to understand that it's not only ADTA, it's also a citrate problem. And here, the graphs of these cases, that we always like to see the blood smear, not only the numbers, because that shows you really the fact, and you can see to believe. And you can see here how the platelet clumps are also observed in citrate, even after 10 minutes. But in 1 hour, the aggregates are bigger and bigger, and you see the impedance with EDTA aggregation in 4 hours is amazing, and 2 hours too, and in 1 hour too. Another fact, EDTA-dependent in vitro platelets decrease causes thrombopenia, but also lower platelet counts without thrombopenia. What that represents, that you can find wrong platelet counting in patients with 200,000 platelets, 250, because the patient don't have 200 or 250, have 400, 500, and the real count is lower than the count that reported. And not on, you can detect inaccurate platelet count also with normal platelet counting. We will see after one evaluation that they selected random samples, running two methods to see that, okay? And that is important to know. Another fact is the frequency of pseudothrombopenia. That there is a lot of different opinions because some people underestimate the pseudothrombopenia. But what is quite clear is that the frequency of pseudothrombopenia in outpatient lab, ambulatory outpatient labs, is from 0.13 to 1%, and in the hospitalized patient from 1.26 to 2%. For that reason, also what is a consensus is in hospitalized patients, the frequency is higher. We are going to see after why. And another fact is few platelet clumps can be seen in up to 10% of all the samples in the lab. How we know that? Because in the same study we did to create the rules of validation for the, we did that in the ICSH and ISLH, that we observed, we selected samples randomly from the lab with no any criteria, and we observed all the slides in the microscope, even if they were normal. What we found is 10% of the samples have small platelet clumps. And some of them have big platelet clumps and they were pseudothrombopenia. But EDTA is not a perfect anticoagulant. Many patients have maybe a difficult blood draw, and that is a fact. If you are pure, you will see that you find some platelet clumps in 10% of your samples. Another fact in pseudothrombopenia is there are some substances published in 1988 and in 2012, that amikacin, kanamycin, aminoglycosides can prevent or dissociate a little if you add it to the EDTA tube very soon, before half an hour after the blood draw, can help to eliminate this problem. Theophylline may prevent to, and dissociate dependent low platelet counts due to pseudothrombocytopenia. But recently, by LIPI, buffered sodium citrate, lithium, calcium chloride, ammonium oxalate, ticlopidine, sodium fluoride, they have checked a lot of substances, acetyl salicylic acid, antiplatelet agents, also potassium azide, also prevent or dissociate the pseudothrombopenia. Another fact, the platelet satellites is the same type of interference or artifact due to antibodies against cryptantigens. And you can see that this picture, beautiful, from this article from Freire, that the platelets go around the neutrophils and you have an abnormal low platelet count. And that is interesting to know. But it's not well known, but also you can find as ADTA-dependent leukoagglutination. And that was described, and I saw the slide because I was there in the Mayo Clinic with Robert Pierre, that they found a patient, and after they published this case in American Journal of Clinical Pathology, they all, and Robert Bernard Prey, they published this case. After I saw another case, only one in my life, by myself, detected in France in one evaluation of one instrument around the end of the last century, in 2000, 1999, I saw a case in France, okay? Not very frequent. But again, if you warm the sample, if you mix the sample, if you add aminoglycosides, you prevent or dissociate this local agglutination. Another fact, certain anticoagulants has been proposed to avoid PCTP. One is very old, magnesium sulfate. There are studies in 1934 in that they published that magnesium sulfate is one of the best anticoagulants for platelets. But also citrate 3-pyridoxal phosphate can also, if you anticoagulate the samples with that, you can prevent the presence of platelet clumps. But they are expensive. And that is the article I have mentioned before. Look here, this is a study in that they were collecting the samples using magnesium sulfate or ADTA. same sample with two anticoagulants. And you can see that using EDTA, you have the counts in blue, in this rhombus blue, and with magnesium sulfate in these squares in red. Look, the first case, with EDTA, 300,000, with magnesium sulfate, 470. What happened here? This patient can have essential thrombocytemia, and you are misdiagnosing this essential thrombocytemia if you report 300,000, and you are going to avoid to detect one disease, maybe because that. Not always provoke thrombopenia, the pseudo-thrombopenia. And here another case, 230, after using magnesium, you have 330. Another 130, 260, another 120, 360. You see, there are several cases here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 9 in 44, about 21% of the cases that have this wrong platelet count don't have thrombopenia. And that makes us think what we have to do to avoid these inaccurate platelet counts due to this phenomenon. We need to review our thoughts, and maybe to do to reflex testing when the histogram of the platelets is not nice, or when we see the possible aggregates in the diff channel. We, the companies and the users, we need to work to avoid to release wrong results due to lower platelet count without thrombopenia. Another interesting fact that I have been follow up till many years ago in 2001, because I saw this article in 2001, 2002, Bragnani et al. Published it in Minerva. They published that they were consecutive collecting cases with pseudothrombopenia and looking for the diseases they have. And they found that 24% of the patients with pseudothrombopenia have solid tumors, 19% have myeloproliferative or lymphoproliferative disorders, 11% have autoimmune disorders. And that represents that the pseudothrombopenia maybe is not only an artifact, can be a symptom. Again, in another article published in 2018 by Zhang, they did similar but with more cases, and they found also that patients with pseudothrombopenia, 69 have a cancer, malignant neoplasm, liver diseases, infections, hematology consultation, 20, autoimmune disorders, 12, and that represents that we need to consider, as we make this mention, that EDTA's dependent pseudothrombopenia has to be had in account and may be obligated to do a checkup or to exclude other related pathology or a disease in a patient that maybe have no related that they have any diagnosis yet. What is the solution of Mindray for this problem? They have been investigated for many years, this situation. And Mindray has developed several methods to eliminate the platelet clumps and to deaggregate them. They use three basic methods. One of them have several methods inside. The first is to warm the sample, and they do that in the chamber. They count the platelets. Second is they are adding deaggregation agents, several ones, in order to dissolve these aggregates. And third, they do a high-speed mixing, but without changing the morphology of the sample of the cells, okay? And here is what happens normally when you are not doing anything, that the platelet become activated and after aggregated and provokes the pseudothrombopenia. But if we can see here, this is an schematic platelet with this rectangle, that is the representing the platelet, in that you can see that there are three main pathways to explain the pseudothrombopenia. One is the tyrosine kinases pathway. The second is the calcium ion channel. And the third is the glycoprotein 2B3A channel, a part of the problem that is more an antibody antigen reaction. And here we can see the three pathways and how Mindray is using several reagents to eliminate this calcium ion channel, or the GP2B3A channel, the glycoproteins, and the tyrosine kinases channel. This factor act solving this problem, and some of them contain several substances. The first factor 1 and 2 gets partial deaggregation, and the factor 3 gets complete deaggregation in 98% of the cases in that you apply this method. And that is published in several articles. In this one in, that was published in Translation Cancer Research, you can see in blue the graph of 23 patients with the platelet count in blue, you can see here, and in red, it's the EDTA tube, but using optical platelets with all these methods that you can see that is very similar than citrate. In some cases, as here, citrate was, optical platelets was even higher than using impedance, but with the same EDTA, but using citrate, using optical platelets with EDTA was higher than using impedance with citrate. That represents that this method from Mindray solved the problem in the majority of the cases and is similar, but in my opinion, a little better than citrate. And that are examples of evaluation that was done by a customer comparing the Mindray channel, optical channel with another company, in that you can see that in one instrument using impedance or platelet F, the count was 14 and 38, and using the optical channel from Mindray was 253. And here you can see the cases with the screens recorded. And here you see another case in that the platelet F impedance was 52, impedance from Mindray was 39, platelet F was 98, but optical platelets from Mindray was 390. Using citrate, the count was higher than using impedance. For this reason, even with citrate, using impedance, that is the method that many labs use, they ask for another tube with citrate, you have 276, but using optical platelets with citrate tube or optical platelets with EDTA, you have a higher result than using citrate with impedance. And that is what I said. It gets similar results than citrate, but even better than citrate using the optical channel in impedance or citrate tube. We need to consider that if you use citrate, you need to, we know that, apply a factor, in this case was 1.1, to get the dilution of the sample with the citrate. That is the problem, how much represent the problem in time. That is the schematic published by Zhang. What represents to have pseudothrombopenia? You need to recheck immediately, other anticoagulants, warm in the sample, recheck. That is costing time. That also was measured in the top. It was 45 minutes for every case with pseudothrombopenia. And if you reflect with the optical method of Mindray, only 1 minute of time lost. That is really not relevant. And also, of course, the patient will be happier because they will not have to have another redraw, and that is important. And the nurses will be also happier. Mindray platelet accuracy. Mindray have been working also in other aspects. Of course, using optical platelets, you can differentiate red cell fragments, lipids, whatever, but also you can have IPF, reticulated platelets. That is very important, as we will see afterwards. Also here, you can see the fragments, how we can differentiate that, but also there are other improvements. Now, Mindray counts the platelets from 2 femtoliters, before it was 5 femtoliters. For this reason, that is a big improvement in the BC6800+, because some of the platelets are even lower than 5 femtoliters, and that with that, the platelet count is much more accurate. Another thing, we know that in thrombopenia, when you repeat the sample several times, the coefficient of variation sometimes is not very good. But when you run several counts and you get the average, you improve the coefficient of variation. That is an automatic mode in 6800+, that when you can set up a rule that every platelet count less than 20,000, you can run 8 times automatically the platelet counting, and you are going to have a much more accurate count. The instrument has been introduced last time, 7 new parameters that are reportable about platelets, and one of the more important is IPF. IPF is really a parameter equivalent to reticulocytes for red cells. reticulated platelets are the younger platelets after they come from the megakaryocyte, and they are for this reason considered young platelets, similar than reticulocytes, and permit to see if the thrombopenia is central or peripheral thrombopenia, if the body is not producing enough platelets or the body is producing normal platelets. Okay, good. The major platelets don't have these nucleic acids that can be stained with new methylene blue or with a fluorescence dye. Here we can see how the IPF is obtained. We can see the small platelets, we can see the normal platelets, adult platelets, and here we can see the young platelets as a percentage of the total platelets, that is the IPF. The reference values of IPF we can find in the literature. Here I made a search of different values by different authors. Okay, you can observe that, and you can find it too in the PubMed, and has been described many applications for IPF, differential diagnosis of thrombopenia, how to detect myelodysplastic syndrome, because also we can observe ineffective thrombopoiesis, the same that we can find an ineffective erythropoiesis with high IRF and normal retics, or high IPF and normal or low platelets. That is useful for the diagnosis of myelodysplastic syndromes. IPF is useful for preeclampsia, for bone marrow stem cell transplantations to see the engraftment if the bone marrow was successful, in thrombocytosis, differentiating reactive from malignant thrombocytosis, in the liver diseases, in platelet transfusion to decide when to transfuse and if the platelets are going to be recovered the next day. That is an important information to decide to do a platelet transfusion or not. In coronary artery diseases and in thrombosis, it's important because IPF is also higher in the patients with thrombosis, and that can help to diagnose it, and also to see the response to antiplatelet drugs. Also, it's important for the diagnosis of infections. Dr. Boro, Dr. Gini, as many others, has seen that IPF comes higher 1 or 2 days before the sepsis, and that permits to prevent, of course, with double check in your hospital, but that hypothesis shows that we can maybe act 1 or 2 days before the sepsis is there, and to avoid many deaths because of sepsis. The future of platelet analysis. Okay, we are working hard now in the combination of MPV, optical MPV, IPF, MPM, MPC, that looks very promising pathway to differentiate between large activated platelets in thrombosis that are big with high MPV, large dysplastic platelets that are degranulated but are not young and not activated because thrombosis, and large immature platelets, and that it's also important. Also, we will include some cases of hereditary macrothrombocytopenias to see there if we can help to differentiate them. That is what we are working with. And of course, in addition to the reportable parameters, there are some seven parameters that are laboratory use only that represent that we can use it to detect disorders in the lab and after confirmed with approved methods. And we have today 15 new parameters related to platelets. That gives us a lot of opportunities to do ROC curves, to do logistic regression, to see how we can combine them to detect the different causes of thrombopenia, thrombocytosis, myelodysplasias, everything the pathologic that affects platelets. Conclusions. Platelet accuracy is very important in laboratory hematology. There are many causes that can be detected observing the scatter plots and educating the lab technicians. EDTA pseudothrombopenia is the most common cause of platelet inaccuracy and can be prevented in many cases using new technologies and reagents. IPF is a new parameter derived from the reticulocyte and optical platelet channel. And as reticulocytes are very important for the anemia diagnosis, IPF is being considered as a very important parameter for the diagnosis of thrombocytopenia and thrombocytosis, but also in coagulation disorders, in thrombosis. Other applications of IPF looks promising, as I said, its use in thrombosis and infections. Thank you for your attention. It was my pleasure to attend again to the CUBE meeting.